Glory to Jesus. Glory, glory, glory to Jesus. Once again, I welcome you all to our celebration this morning, today being the 18th Sunday in Ordinary Time. The theme of our reflection this morning is, a man's life does not consist in the abundance of his possessions. Last Sunday, the focus of our reflection was on prayer. We saw how God was willing to negotiate with Abraham for the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah. The fact that God was willing to spare the city if only Abraham had continued his negotiation further. You remember that Abraham started with 50 to 45 to 40, 30, 20, and 10. My question is, why did Abraham stop? And Jesus Christ gave us a parable in last Sunday's gospel passage about a friend who went to beg for his friend for loaves of bread at night. And Jesus Christ told us that parable so that we can be persistent in prayer. Don't stop praying. Continue to pray. Jesus Christ went on to say, whoever we ask shall receive. Whoever seeks will find. And anyone who knocks shall find. The door will be opened. Because God is the Father. Who will never give his children snake when they ask for fish? He will never give you scorpion when you are asking for bread. Today, surprisingly, a young man prayed to Jesus, imploring him to come and settle a property dispute with his brother. But Jesus, who had said that whatever we ask, we shall receive, responded by saying, man, who made me a judge or divider over you? Luke chapter 12, verse 14. Definitely, this response of Jesus did not go that well with the man who came with faith, expecting that Jesus, a promoter of social justice, would heed his prayer. The sin raises a lot of questions. Could it be that there are some prayers that God does not answer? Is there anything wrong with asking God to bless us with riches, with financial prosperity? Is there anything wrong with it? After all, didn't God so shower riches on Abraham to the extent that the land could no longer accommodate himself and Lot, his cousin? You know that song we often sing, Abraham's blessings are mine. Abraham's blessings are mine. Okay. Yes, Abraham was blessed. Yes, it is not a sin to pray to God to bless you with riches, with good things in this life. However, let us pay attention to what Jesus is teaching us today by his refusal to follow this man to settle a property dispute. Lesson number one, beware of all covetousness. Say that. Reading through our gospel passage, it is easy for us to wrongly assume that Jesus was condemning riches. But in truth, Jesus was actually condemning the following. Number one, the worship of riches. The feeling that our life is secure based on the abundance of our possessions. Our willingness to do anything just for the sake of riches. That is covetousness on the part of the brother who refused to release the father's inheritance. Selfishness. thinking only of ourselves, like saying only you are come. Wastefulness, wastefulness, storing up riches instead of helping to make the lives of others better. I can go on to expand on these 5 points, but the message is clear. To be rich is not a sin, but to worship riches and to fail to use your property properly, failure to use riches properly is a mortal sin. Jesus did not condemn the rich. Rather, he condemns covetousness. You see, that is a big word, covetousness. You know the meaning of covetousness? Greediness. Greediness. The desire to grab. Avarice. Avarice. Inordinate desire for another person's possession. That is covetousness. You see something that belongs to your brother or to your sister, and the moment you see that thing is spinning you in your body, you just wish like you could just kill your brother and take that thing. That is a sin, a mortal sin. Come. Lesson number two. You must take care of your soul. Be rich towards God. Take care of your soul. Be rich towards God. Say that. The rich man in the parable said, you know, he said, when he had hammered, you know, this our language for hammer, you see, the land of the rich man brought forth plentifully. If you look at the original Greek word for land, it is not just one small parcel of land. They are referring to a very large portion of land, like the land. It brought forth plentifully. So the guy had an abundance. He had too much. Too much. And then he started worrying. As he was troubled. He said, what am I going to do? You see, when you don't have money, you are troubled. How am I going to get money? And when you have the money, you are still troubled. What am I going to do with it? What am I going to do? Which kind of investment will better pass? He was troubled. And in his trouble, look at what he came up with. Look at his conclusion. He said, I will say to my soul, you have ample goods laid up for many years. Take your ease. Eat, drink, and be merry. The rich man did not realize that the survival of his soul does not depend on earthly riches. If you recall, our penny catechism teaches us that we are made of body and soul, and that we must take care of our soul more than our bodies. Why? Because the soul is immortal. You still remember now? Huh? Still remember? God made you body and soul. So your soul is more important than your body. For what shall it profit a man if he gains the whole world and loses his soul? What shall a man give in return for his life? Matthew chapter 16, verse 26. Dear friends in Christ, the reason this man is called a fool is that he acted as if there is no God. He met prosperity. He was prosperous. And in his conclusion of how to enjoy his prosperity, he left out God. As the psalmist will say, only the fool We say in his heart that there is no God. This man is called a fool because he did not consider God. He was wise enough to know how to plant, but was foolish by his failure to be rich towards God. And what does it mean to be rich towards God? Because see, Jesus concluded our gospel passage this morning by saying that so is he who lays up treasure for himself and is not rich towards God. And that is an important clarification. Jesus Christ is not condemning riches. He's not saying that it's a sin to be rich. If you legitimately do your work, you will be rich. If you work very hard, you can be rich. But the problem is, when you are rich with money or with the things of this world, and you fail to be rich towards God, that is the problem. What does it mean to be rich towards God? According to Saint Bede, he says, he who wishes to be rich in God should not lay up treasure to himself, but distribute his possessions among the poor. He who wishes to be rich towards God should not lay up treasure to himself, but distribute his possessions among the poor. Even Saint Augustine tells us that he is rich to God who is full of God, and therefore who is full of love and therefore of God. So if your heart is full of love, then you are full of God. St. Augustine was quoting 1 John chapter 4 verse 16, which says, God is love, and he who abides in love abides in God, and God in him. So the gospel explains, if you have love, you have God. If you have love, you have God. He says, what does the rich man have if he does not have love? Nothing. He may have private jets, he may have cars, he may have companies, but if there is no love in his heart, then he's a poor man. He's really poor. There's a saying that says, it says, don't be so rich, I mean, don't be so poor that the only thing you have is money. Have you heard that saying before? Don't become so poor that the only thing you have in this life is money. If money is only what you have, then you are truly most to be pitied. He says, if a poor man has love, what has he not? In other words, if you have love, you have everything. If you have love in your heart, that means you have God in your heart. And if you have God, you have everything. He says, you think him to be rich, perhaps, whose chest is full of gold. And is he not so, whose conscience is full of God? He is truly rich in whom God deigns to dwell. So you see, you don't need to envy anybody. You don't need to start looking at that car and that house and say, which day I will be like this now? If you have God in you, you have everything. And if you have love in your heart, you have God. So to be rich towards God is to share, charity, give, help the poor, help the needy, help the less privileged. Most times we look at ourselves and say, oh, I don't have. We don't like to compare ourselves with those who are worse than us. We like to compare ourselves with those who are better than us. But the truth of the matter is that you are still better than many people. Because if you go out and check, that thing that you reject, that thing that you call small house, eh? That thing you are calling small house, somebody is praying for it night and day and say, oh, I wish that can be my house. The thing you take for granted is what another person is praying for. Dear friends in Christ, what do you hope to do with all that extra money you have stored up in a bank account? It's a question for us. What do you hope to do with all that extra money stored up in a bank account? Have you beaten your will? You know what is a will? How your property will be distributed after your death. Have you written your will? Or you think it's too early to write your will? How are you sure that God may not demand your soul this very night? And if God was to demand your soul this night, would he call you a fool or a wise person? You know, some people are so foolish to the extent that they don't even tell their spouses how much money they have. They know, no, I won't tell her. It's my mama. Oh, I won't tell him. How can I tell him? And so you have stored up treasure for yourselves. Nobody even knows that you have this money. I once read an article some time ago. It's about a man who died, and he had billions in his account. And nobody knew he had so much money in his account. Of course, he was not expecting to die at that time. And his wife started begging everywhere to raise money just to bury this man. To the extent that she almost started selling herself, looking for money just to feed the children. And this man had money, but she did not know. Only his account officer knew that he had money. Dear friends in Christ, let us think about these things. Think, what do you plan to do if God calls you this night? What will he call you? A wise person or a fool? According to St. Ambrose, the things we cannot carry with us are not our own. Did you hear that? St. Ambrose says, the things you cannot carry with you do not belong to you. So if you cannot carry that house with you, to that kingdom come, it's not your own. If you cannot drive that car to heaven, it's not your own. That money you have stashed up in the account, if you cannot withdraw it and use it for flight tickets to heaven, it's not your own. You know, some time ago, a priest told a story, very funny story, but it's made me think. A very wealthy man was being buried in this particular village. You know, the man was the richest man in the village. And everybody came around for the burial. And there was this madman who was hovering around the place during the burial ceremony. So by the time all the other ceremonies were finished, a few people, just a few people went to the burial ground actually to put the man down. The rest were busy sharing food, eating and drinking, dancing, enjoying themselves. So this madman went to the burial spot where they were burying the man. And as they were lowering the casket into the ground, the man was looking quietly. And everybody was looking. Then he started putting sand inside. The madman said, No. How can you just put sand inside? No. This grave is too small. Please make it wider. Widen it. So that we can carry this house and put inside. So that we can put all those cars inside. He said, it's too small. How can you just put look at all his property. See all his plenty property. And the only thing you want to put inside is just the casket. No. That's not fair. Anyway, they drove the madman away, but he had made his point. St. Ambrose says, the things we cannot carry with us are not our own. What are the things that we can carry with us? St. Ambrose tells us, goodness, virtue, kindness. You see, the good things you do to people, those things will always be remembered. And that is actually what is your own. So that is what Jesus Christ was saying when he says, store treasure for yourselves in heaven. Store up treasure for yourselves in heaven. You can lose your money today. Armed robbers can come and steal your money and take away your money, take away your car. Your business can crash today. But there are some things that can never leave you. Some things that are your own forever. Kindness. The kindness. Somebody whom you were kind to cannot come back tomorrow and say, no, he was not kind to me, or she was not kind to me. Is it possible? That is your own. That is what you carry. It's a virtue. Virtue alone is the companion of the dead. Mercy alone follows us. And mercy alone gains abode for the departed. It is what you give out. That is what you take with you to heaven. Lesson number 3. Wealth and vanity are not the same thing. Say that. Wealth and vanity are not the same thing. You know, many people can actually read our first reading and they will not understand it. But let me explain what Ecclesiastes is saying in that first reading. The word vanity is the English translation of the Hebrew word hebel, which means breath or air. So it's vanity. And it's just breath. That's what is it? It's gone. In our first reading, the preacher's aim is to draw our attention to the futility, that is the emptiness, the senselessness, the mere breath of toiling and working so hard for wealth which neither brings us satisfaction nor lasts forever. It is mere breath to work so hard and hand over riches to your children or to even maybe it's even strangers that will get your money. And they will not value it because they did not work for it. You know, there's this story of a man who was traveling to a far distant country. And he had this friend that he trusted so much. This friend is his good friend. And then he told his friend, he said, I'm traveling far. You see, I decided, I don't know whether I will ever be back. I'm not sure I will ever be back. I'm not sure. I may not come back. I may come back, I may not come back. And he gave his friend a key. And his friend asked him, what is this key meant for? He says, this key is the key to a particular room in my house. That room I've never entered. Nobody enters that room. You know that room? The friend said, yes. All my money, all my gold, everything I have is contained inside that room. But you know what? You are going to wait for me. If after 2 years I don't return, open that room. Take whatever you see there. You are my good friend. I want you to have a good life. And then the man started on his journey. The man was going. He was going. He never even reached my road. This is friend, you're wrong. What's happening? Okay. He gave me the wrong key. He told him, he said, wait for 2 years. If you don't see me, then you open that place. This man don't even wait. He didn't even wait for 10 seconds. As soon as the friend just turned, they go wrong. So had he been, he died. That is just telling what would have happened. Dear friends in Christ, it is vanity. It is mere pride to work so hard and toil and toil and toil and toil just because you want to hand over riches to your children who may not even value it because they never worked for it. It is also vanity. It is mere breath to spend your health in an attempt to make money. It is useless to spend your health to make money because you can never use any amount of money to buy back your health. You can't. They know they sell kidney for market. They know they sell liver for market. Even if you see buy, maybe you know go fit your system. There are many people who are seriously sick. They have the money. They have the money. But the doctors cannot help them. So it is vanity. It is just, you just walk and walk and walk and walk. You don't rest, you don't sleep. See, the first one even said, he said, even after walking and walking and walking, you come home at night and you still cannot sleep. For all his days are full of pain and his work is a vexation. Even in the night, his mind does not rest. He said, is that not vanity? But you see, dear friends in Christ, our first reading is not fatalistic. It only warns us of the danger of making the pursuit of wealth our highest priority in life. There is a way to be wealthy that would not amount to vanity. This is when we are committed to training our children instead of simply transferring wealth to them. Do not spend your whole day walking. Come home and rest. Come home early and rest. Do not be so concerned about how much millions you want to leave for your children. Rather be concerned about educating them. When I mean educating them, I don't mean letting them have a degree. They may have degrees, PhD self. It's not just degree education. I'm talking about a sound moral education. teach them not simply to have money, but to know the value for money. Train your children so that when eventually you give them money, they will know that this money is not easy to come by. And they will know how to use it. Then your wealth will make sense. Don't leave your children at the mercy of house helps. Don't leave your children at the mercy of house helps. And don't assume that what they get in school can suffice for them. Don't assume that maybe the 8 or 9 hours or 10 hours they spend in school is okay for them. So if they return back from school, they don't even need to see you. Maybe till the next day. Some parents only see their children maybe for 1 hour a day. They spend only 1 hour a day with their children. And that 1 hour a day is just, welcome, sir. Welcome, sir. Okay, how are you? What did you learn something in school today? Okay. And that's all. You know the one that's even breaking my head? Some parents now send their children to boarding school from primary school, as in primary school, boarding school. So the child is just 4 years old, or the child is just 5 years old and is in a boarding house. And the child will have to wait for up to see the parents maybe once a month or once a year. 1 month in a whole year. That's the only time the child will see the parents. And the child is growing up like that. Primary school boarding house, secondary school boarding house, university. Why? Economy is hard now. The economy is hard. The economy has always been hard. But now look at the kind of children. Look at the generation we are producing. Look at the kind of children we are having. Children committing suicide. Children to manage crisis. They don't have anybody to talk to. Children, they don't have anybody to talk to. They are having difficulties in school. They are facing peer pressure. Or they are being sexually molested. They can't talk to anybody because the father and mother, they are not there for him or her. Just leave the children. House helps. Sexually molesting children. And the parents are not aware. The parents do not know. You see, your child is no longer walking straight. Your child is now is limping. And you do not ask. Because you don't care. Because the only thing you care about is money. Today you are in London, tomorrow you are in America, next tomorrow you are in Dubai. You're making money to hand over to the child. Only to come home one day, meet your child dead with a suicide note. So what is the essence of all that money you are making? All that time you cannot spend with your children? Mere breath. Vanity. Vanity. Lesson number 4. Some prayers are not worth answering. Say that. Some prayers are not worth answering. They get some prayer where God knows the answer. If you read Luke chapter 12, beginning from verse 1, down to where our gospel passage today begins, you would immediately realize that this man actually interrupted Jesus. He was not even listening to what Jesus was saying. Are not 5 sparrows sold for 2 pennies? Are not one of them is forgotten before God? Why, even the hairs of your head are all numbered. Fear not, you are of more value than many sparrows. Jesus Christ was teaching the people about the need to trust God, to have confidence in God. Jesus Christ said that you are going to face persecution, but don't worry. When you come before them, don't worry about what you have to say. I will put something in your mouth that you will say. The Holy Spirit will help you. All of a sudden, this man just raised up his hand. Just the way, for instance, I'm giving this opening now. Somebody just raised up his hand. I said, Father, I have a problem in my house. Please come on. You follow me now. Let us go to the house because we need to settle this land matter. That's exactly something, similar thing that happened. You see, sadly, many of us are in the shoes of this man. We come to church not because we desire to improve our spiritual life, but because we want our share of property. This is where many fake, you know today, we have so many fake men and women of God opening churches everywhere, doing all kinds of things. Recently, I don't want to use the word pastor again because they don't deserve that name. You know the word pastor, it means shepherd. It means shepherd of souls. So these people are not pastors. What are they? Businessmen. Con men. Deceivers. Something happened recently. Some of these con men, they went to go and make negotiation with one white man. And they asked the man to dress like an Israeli. They asked him to dress like an Israeli impostor. Have you watched the movie Jesus of Nazareth? They look for somebody that resembled the man that acted Jesus, and they asked him to dress like Jesus, and they brought him to Kenya, and he started dancing on the streets, and they were saying Jesus. The con men were telling people that Jesus has come back, that this is Jesus. What insult! What insult! And they keep on doing more and more. Fake men of God, they take advantage of us because they know that the economy is bad. They know that we are not looking for salvation of our souls. Nobody's preaching salvation of souls anymore. Nobody's preaching repent from sin. Why you tune into television? Do you hear anybody preaching? Repent! Because you will die your sins. You don't hear anybody preaching that. What do you hear? My God is not a poor God. I declare that this year you will buy your car. This year you will have a dream job. They know the economy is bad. And they know that we are just like this man that was asking Jesus to come and provide property. And so, they twist God's word to suit us. They tell us what we want to hear, not what we should hear. They give false interpretation to the word of God. And then they get us excited. When you attend any of this fake church, they'll do everything possible to make you excited. Even to the extent of going to invite comedians. They go and pay comedians to come and entertain you. So it's entertainment center you are seeing all over the place. It's not church. Entertainment. And then you are so excited. When you are excited, then they get to make demand of you. They get to make demand of you. They control you. That's why you see you see videos of people eating grass. You wonder, this is not the reason. It's a lie. It's not because they don't use the reason. It's because of what the mind programming, mind twisting that has been done on them. So they are no longer allowed to use their common sense. saying, they lie down there. The common man jumping on people's body. Where's their sense? Because they've so twisted the word of God. May God save us. May God save us from fake men and women of God. Jesus told this man the bitter truth. This man came. Jesus could see his heart. He knew that all he wanted was prosperity. Jesus told him the bitter truth. And I'll tell you that bitter truth. Jesus did not come from heaven to make us millionaires. That was not his primary purpose. His primary purpose was to lead us to heaven. Salvation of our souls. According to St. Ambrose, St. Augustine, this man begged half an inheritance on earth. The Lord offered him a whole one in heaven. He gave him more than he asked for. The same Jesus who was willing to heal the sick, to raise the dead, was not willing to go with this young man. Not because Jesus supports injustice, but because Jesus wanted him to have true riches. Jesus used the occasion to draw his attention to something of higher value, his soul and eternity. Some prayers are not answered, not because God is incapable of answering, but because we ask wrongly. Do you hear that? Some prayers are not answered, not because God is incapable of answering, but because we ask wrongly. As James put it, he said, you do not have because you do not ask. You ask and you do not receive because you ask wrongly. To spend it on your passions, unfaithful creatures. Do you not know that friendship with the world is enmity with God? Therefore, whoever wishes to be a friend of the world makes himself an enemy of God. James chapter 4, verse 2 to 4. This is the reason why many of our prayers are not answered. The reason why Jesus Christ refused to follow this man to his home. Because when you are asking, Jesus Christ is also looking at your heart. Don't ask wrongly. Ask so that you can be a blessing to others. Don't ask so that you can make money and shine. Don't ask so that your neighbors will envy you. I say, oh yes. Ask so that you can be a blessing to others. And finally, lesson number 5. Set your minds on things that are above. Set your minds on things that are above, not on things that are here on earth. You know, let me ask you a question. Do you hold this doctrine? If it is not making money, it is not making sense. Is that what you believe? That anything that is not making money is not making sense. Do you dream of having lots of cars and houses that you wouldn't know which one is which? There's one musician that sang a song like that. I think it's Wyclef Jean. You see, when I was young, I used to dream of having lots of cars and houses that I wouldn't know which one is which. And some people, you know the prayer of some people, they pray that, let me have so much money in my accounts that I will not even know my account balance. Because if you know your account balance, that means you are poor. Some people, their prayer is that they don't even want to know They don't want to know how much is their account balance. So for them, I have many. Too much money. Is that your dream? To have too much money? Or do you consider the good life as taking breakfast in Hawaii, lunch in Dubai, and then that same day, supper in Lekki or Banana Island? Is that your dream? Are these your life goals? Then you should reconsider. St. Paul tells us in our second reading to set our minds on things that are above, putting to death immorality, impurity, evil desires, covetousness, and especially telling of lies. Somebody told me a lie recently, and it didn't pay me. Don't lie. Stop telling lies. Don't ever lie to anybody. Because no matter what, the truth will come out. And it's so painful when the truth comes out. Why do we lie? Why do we commit immorality? Why? Why do we do all these evil things? It's not because we're looking for money. It's because you are dreaming of having lots of cars and houses, and you don't know which one is which. And so you feel that the only way to make it is to do all these evil things. Don't fall into this trap. Don't be like the seed sown among thorns. According to Jesus, these are those who hear the word of God, but the ears of this word, the delight in riches and the desire to have other things enter in and choke the word, and it proves unfruitful. Mark chapter 4, verse 18 to 19. Stop aiming to be the richest man on earth. Satan will so entice you that you will end up losing your religion. Aim rather for sainthood. Aim rather for sainthood. In conclusion, don't be a fool. Say that.
Don't be a fool.
Money is useless without your soul. Do you feel blessed with some money? Do you feel blessed with some money? As your business prospered, then, according to Jesus, give a feast. Invite the poor. Invite the maimed. Those that cannot walk again. The lame, the blind, and you will be blessed. Because they cannot repay you, you will be repaid at the resurrection of the just. Luke chapter 14, verse 13 to 14. Do you have any extra money? You have been able to take care of your needs. You know, what every human being needs is not so much. It's not so much. Is there anybody here that can eat one bag of rice a day? You cannot eat one pot of rice. So there's a certain amount that you need. The other extra, you don't need it. There are many people who don't have. Do you have something extra, and you are thinking of what investment to do? Are you thinking of building a new barn? You know this man, this rich fool in our gospel passage, He thought and thought and said to himself, I will pull down my old bands and build new ones. Are you thinking of pulling down your old bands and building a new band? You have it in the bellies of the poor, says St. Basil and St. Ambrose. You know, poor people, just think of their stomach, their stomach. That is your bank. That should be your bank. Store your extra money in the stomach of the poor, according to St. Basil and St. Ambrose. In fact, St. Basil continues. He said, thou hast storehouses, the bosoms of the poor, the houses of widows and orphans, the mouths of infants. Let these be thy bands, and they will last you forever. Let this be your storage. The houses of the poor, the bosoms of the poor and the infants, the mouths of infants, the houses of widows and orphans. St. Basil again, in his homily, says, he is a despoiler who, when he receives what he ought to dispense, considers it as his own. The bread thou hast is the bread of the famishing. Thy robe is the robe of the naked. Thy silver that is buried in the ground is the silver of the indigent. Wherefore dost thou wrong so many poor whom thou mightest support? Let me explain that. What St. Basil is saying. If God is blessing you, God is not blessing you for yourself. Don't think your money is your own. God is blessing you so that you can be a blessing to others. God is blessing you so that you can be a blessing to others. That extra money that you are thinking of where to keep it is not your own. It belongs to the hungry. It belongs to the hungry. Don't think it's your own. And you do a great wrong when you take that which you ought to give out for yourself. You do them a great wrong. May God bless His words in our hearts.